انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له، واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى اله وصحبه وسلم. Continue, inshallah ta'ala, with the six pillars of al-Iman. Last week, we started to talk about al-Imanu billah, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being the first and the most important pillar of al-Iman. That because of this pillar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens and the earth and created us. There is no goodness in this life without the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the owner of all things. And everything belongs to him subhanahu wa ta'ala, and everything shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa anna ila rabbika al-muntaha. To your Lord is the end of all things. Everything will end to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he subhanahu wa ta'ala, the treasures of all things, he's the owner of the treasures of all things. Wa min shay'in illa 'indana khazayun. There is nothing whatsoever unless with us, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is its treasures, whether it's physical or non-physical, whether we know it or we don't know it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most high, the most rich, the most merciful, the most wise. And the real successful person in this life is the one that will have his heart attached at all times to the creator of the heavens and the earth. And this is the foundation of our religion and the foundation for the rest of the pillars of al-Iman and the whole entire life and the religion and all that exists. And if we just heard after the salah about how the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a person can be healthy and all of a sudden he's sick or he dies, or vice versa. And this is the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The cure is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he talked about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَإِذَا مَرِضْتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِينِ. When I'm sick, he's the one that gave me cure. الَّذِي يُمِيتُنِي ثُمَّ يُحْيِينِ. And he's the one that would cause me to die, and he's the one that would give me life. Everything is owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whoever thinks that he is created on the face of earth for one to follow his desires and that's it, this is actually a foolish thing, because everybody shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it doesn't matter what age, circumstance, whatever there is, everything is owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But one important thing, part of the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we believe in the names and attributes of Allah, which is so many in the Quran, almost every verse in the Quran ends with one or two of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his attributes. Because our whole entire life is to witness these names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the implications of it in our life. Because this is a constant act of worship that the believer do to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise, Al-Hakim subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, as a rule for all the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. Nothing is the like of Him. And He's the All-Hear, the All-Seer. So anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran or the authentic Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is ghaib, this is unseen to us, we believe in it, we know the meaning of it, and nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have wisdom as human beings. We have wisdom, we do things for a reason. Right? And some people are more wiser than others. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called some of the people that Allah gave them some wisdom. As Luqman, for example, قَدَ أَتَيْنَا لُقْمَانَ الْحِكْمَةِ. We gave Luqman al-Hikmah. And what's the wisdom? The wisdom means that things are being put in the right place of it. Right? So when the Hikmah is there, the human beings, they understand what Hikmah means, what's the wisdom means. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-Hakim. Nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No similarities whatsoever, no resemblance whatsoever to the Hikmah of the human beings or the wisdom of the human being. Nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. With having the firm belief, of course, that we witness that in our life. And when we say nothing is the like of Allah, we might not be able to comprehend the wisdom behind everything that happens. We might not comprehend it, but we have to have the conviction in our hearts that it's by the most wise subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whoever lives with this, he will constantly be in state of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We as human beings, we like all kinds of afiyah or security and goodness in this life and in the hereafter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most wise, He tests His slaves with whatever He will, subhanahu wa ta'ala. لا يسأل عما يفعلون يسألون. Nobody is to question Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are the ones to be questioned. The Muslim always asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for al-afiyah, for all means of goodness in this life and in the hereafter. The Prophet taught us this. But if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose for the believer in this life to be tested with something that in his innate he doesn't like it, because we as human beings, we don't like to be in pain. We don't like to die, for example. This is something noble. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. But once the believer is afflicted with anything, he should, and this is the type of where a Muslim will choose to be pleased. This is not something that will come from the innate of the human being, it comes from the belief, what matters of an iman, that he will be pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Pleased that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most wise, he's the one that decreed. He's the most wise. His decree, it is not just for the sake of testing the human being, and instead, he's the most wise subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's more merciful to us than our own selves. See how you have so much mercy towards your own self? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more merciful, and His mercy nobody can comprehend it. And the Prophet والسلام, when he was sitting with the companions عنهم, and they saw the woman from As-Sabi, they were after a war or so, and she lost her child, and she was panicking. Once she found her child, she got very close to her, and she started breastfeeding him. And the Prophet وسلم, and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum seeing this clear example that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that created the human beings like this, and that He is the one that created this love towards that child in the heart of the mother and so on, the Prophet ﷺ said to the companions, ask them a question, أَتَرَوْنَ هَذِهِ طَارِحًا وَلَدَهَا فِي النَّارِ. Do you think this woman will throw her child in the fire? They said, of course not, O Prophet of Allah. Right? Then the Prophet ﷺ said, الله أرحم بأحدكم من هذه بولدها. He's saying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and in it that Allah, this is swearing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more merciful to you than this woman towards her child. So whatever happens to the Muslim in this life, if he worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a result of what happens, sabr, shukr, patience, being grateful, witnessing the wisdom of Allah. And if we come up from tonight, this issue of witnessing the wisdom of Allah, this is a way of life. Just to witness the wisdom of Allah. In anything that happened, if there's a breeze that comes, it is decreed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a reason. So when the Muslim is constantly witnessing the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether he comprehended or not, but he's witnessing it. Right? So he's witnessing that whatever is happening by the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, immediately he will be pleased. And as the ulama, they say, Shaykh Sayyid Tayyib rahimahullah explained very nicely. He said, Al-Maqdur, we're going to the sixth pillar of Al-Iman. No, Al-Qadr is the sixth pillar of Al-Iman. But if we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the right way, then the sixth pillar of Al-Iman will be no problem settled in the heart. Because if a person believes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most wise, the matter is over. Even if the person does not comprehend things. So before the maqdur is the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have something to do before it and you have something to do after it. And this is the implication of believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The maqdur or this decree can be easy, either something that you would like as a human being or something that we don't like as a human being, regardless of anything else. So before it, what should be done as an act of worship? And after it, what act of worship should be done? Before it is التوكل على الله تعالى, to rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't know the maqdur. We don't know what's going to happen. So we rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We depend with our hearts on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fully, because He's the creator of the heavens and the earth. And this is the التوكل especially, is the highest level of the tawheed. When we talk about the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the highest level that a person can reach in the tawheed and the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he relies on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. This is would never happen unless a person is on the complete tawheed, to rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And the evidence of that, first of all, it's mentioned many, many verses in the Quran, and also in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about the 70,000 those who will enter Jannah without hisab, without reckoning. Right? The ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is much more than that, of course. But 70,000 among them, and there's another authentic narration in Musnad Imam Ahmad, that with every one of them, there's a 70,000. So this is by the mercy of Allah. These 70,000, they are special 70,000. They will enter Jannah without reckoning, without being asked, without being questioned. Right? The believers will be questioned, and then they will enter Jannah. They won't be touched by the hellfire. Some of them won't be touched by the hellfire, they won't be punished. They will go through the stages of the Day of Judgment, and one of which is Al-Hisab. They will be asked. And this is what the Prophet said, أن تزول قدم عبد حتى يسأل عن أربع. That the foot of the slave of Allah would never depart from the Day of Judgment till he's asked about four things. عن عمره فيما أفناء, what his life, how did he waste it, how did he spend his life. وعن شبابه, and his youth, especially the youth, although the عمر, or the lifespan includes the youth. But the youth specifically mentioned because this is the most productive years of one's life. Is it wasted like most of the youth would do because they get deceived by their power and energy and health and so on? Or it's used for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us for. So the youth years will be asked. A person will be asked about his youth. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful that a person repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَعَمْ مَالِهِ and his wealth. مِنْ أَيْنَ اكْتَسَبَ هُوَ فِيمَا أَنْفَقَ. Two questions with regards to the wealth. How did he earn it? And how did he spend it? This is two in one. And also عن علمي لكم خير ماذا عمل به. About his knowledge, what did he do, act according to his knowledge. So everybody will ask, will be asked, except these 70,000. They won't be even asked in the Day of Judgment. They go to Jannah straight, no question. So what are these 70,000 among the ummah of the Prophet ﷺ? And it's in a long hadith. The Prophet ﷺ, when he said that and he left, the companions start debating with each other. What are these 70,000? One said, these are the ones that was born and lived as Muslims, not like us. We're non-Muslims and became Muslims. They thought this is maybe them. Right? And this is the attitude of the Sahaba, putting themselves down. It's a very healthy thing. Not to be a negative thing, it's a good thing that makes the person humble. And some said maybe these are the ones that never committed sins or so. So they start saying things. And then the Prophet ﷺ came out to them and he informed them, what are these 70,000 people? What's their qualities? He said, هُمُ الَّذِينَ لَا يَسْتَرْقُونَ وَلَا يَخْتَوُونَ وَلَا يَتَطَيَّرُونَ وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. All the three qualities before يَتَوَكَّلُونَ, they rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's all about the tawakkul also, to rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. الَّذِينَ لَا يَسْتَرْقُونَ, those who do not ask for ruqya. They make ruqya on themselves. The Prophet ﷺ did that. That's from the kamal tawheed. This is from the perfection of tawheed to do that. To make ruqya on yourself, to recite Quran on yourself when you're sick and so on. This is part of our deen. To make ruqya on someone, this is also part of the deen. But without them waiting, without them asking you, you do it. You visit the sick, make ruqya on them. Right? If a person is sick, if he asks someone to make ruqya on him, this is not haram, this is permissible. But the highest level, right, that they won't ask for someone to make ruqya on them. Why? Because there's a slight attachment to the heart here. What if a person asks, he's someone righteous or alim or someone, and he asks him, please make ruqya on me. It's permissible. As long as his heart, he knows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that accused. So that alim or this righteous person or whatever, he makes ruqya, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will for that person to be cured. This heart can be now have some form of attachment to the one that make the ruqya more, or well, it makes some deficiency in his reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So anyway, so these 70,000, they don't even have this in them. They don't ask. And they don't use the yaktawun, being, I always forget that word that I mentioned last time, with being branded in matters of cure, right? branded, yes, although this is permissible. Anas radiallahu anhu did that in Surah. And, but it's the less of what the best quality of the person should be when it comes to branded means of pure. وَلَا يَتَطَيَّرُونَ They don't, they're never pessimistic. Right? Which is something that is present in every human being. The Prophet ﷺ said that in the hadith. That every person will have this in himself. You see something, the day starts in a certain way and you feel something in your heart. It's normal to feel something in your heart. Maybe this is not going to be a good day. So what a Muslim should do, should push that feeling away and rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because what you saw, the weather, this bird, this cat, this or that, or things are not working good in the beginning of the day, doesn't mean anything. It's not something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it this way, that means it's going to be always this way. And what sums all of these qualities together, وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ On the Lord, they rely on Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the significance of saying, وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ On the Lord, right? Not يَتَوَكَّلُونَ عَلَى رَبِّهِمْ The meaning is the same. If you say يَتَوَكَّلُونَ عَلَى رَبِّهِمْ, it means they rely on the Lord. But the hadith says, on the Lord they rely. You see the difference here? This is the exclusiveness. That means they don't rely on anyone whatsoever, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the highest level of التوحيد when it's established in the heart. What negates the tawheed? What weakens the tawheed is when the heart is attached to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the foundation of the shirk, associating partners with Allah. Even when it's shirk asghar and shirk akbar, when it's minor and major, the minor is in the category of sins. But why it's called shirkun asghar, minor shirk? Because these types of sins have some form of attachment in the heart to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like swearing by other than Allah. Swearing by something that means there's something that you're exalting it. So if it's not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is a problem. And this is by the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من حلف بغير الله فقد كفر الأشرك. Whoever swears by other than Allah, he had committed kufr or shirk. Right? So this is a minor shirk. Or wearing an amulet, for example, thinking that this will benefit or harm or whatever. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of all things. And He did not make it a means of cure. This is nothing whatsoever. So when the heart relies on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sincerely, the person will be free from all of these things that makes the heart attached to. Even, but for us to understand it properly, even being persistently in the state of sin. If a person is persistently committing a sin, that means there's a disease in the heart. Why is he continuously committing that sin? He's not repenting and back and forth. No, he is chose the path of a sin. He still makes salah and zakah, mashallah, good Muslim, but there's a sin that he is not quitting, he's not repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from. There is something in his heart that makes his heart attached to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rely on other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not make him a kafir, does not make him a mushrik, an associated partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does not associate anyone with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the deceit is there. Deceit is there even if it's in the level of sin. So that's why a Muslim should work on his heart to purify it, and once the heart is pure, the speech and actions also will be pure. And if the speech and actions are not pure, there's sins there. That means the heart has diseases in it. So whoever says, my heart is clean, and what's important is what's in the heart, and the actions and so on, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful, most forgiving. And that person is saying that while he's committing sins, he is out of the lack of knowledge, or he's lying, because it doesn't work this way. If the heart is pure, the speech and actions will be pure, away from sins. If there's a sin committed, that means there's something in the heart that the person needs to work on to purify his heart. So to rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-hayy alladhi la yamut. This is the implications of believing in Allah. وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتُ Rely, this is the order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rely on al-hayy. Al-hayy is the ever-living. الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتُ He never dies. Other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, anyone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they die. They have to die. In the creation of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordained death on everyone, even his most beloved, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There is no one better than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is the best man ever walked on the face of earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّكَ مَيِّتٌ وَإِنَّهُ مَيِّتٌ You will die and they will die. Right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ever-living. So that's why He is the only one that the hearts should rely on. And He is the ever-living and the most wise and the provider and the sustainer. The matter is a serious one in the dunya. This world takes us away from pondering over and implementing the effects of these things and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, when even every hadith, any hadith that we read, any verse in the Quran should bring from the heart the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the belief in the names and attributes of Allah. The love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the love by itself is asl kulli haraka fil alam, as the early generations of Islam said. The foundation of any move that a human being will do is based on love. The love of life, the love not to die, he loves this life, the love of money, the love of his wife, the love of his children, the love of his own self and desires. So the love of things makes people walk and sit and do all kinds of things. So as a result of that, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the hearts of the believers is the thing that makes them move and sit and go and do all kinds of things. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that created this love in the heart. So He's the creator of love. So He's the one that deserved to be loved, the most perfect love. Right? And so on. So this, the subject of the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is part of the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, implementing this in our life is a great thing. And if you take any hadith, for example, this morning we were discussing a hadith about كل الناس يغدو فبايع النفس أو فمعتقى أو مبيقى. This hadith is have some words before it. Starts with الطهور, شطر الإيمان, purification is half of the إيمان, and Alhamdulillah fills the Mizan, the balance of the deed, and Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah fills or fills between the heavens and the earth. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, الصلاة نور, salah is light, والصدقة برهان, and charity is an evidence of one's إيمان. والصبر ضياء, patience is ضياء. ضياء is light, but it's different than نور. نور is light, but ضياء is light with heat, with struggle. That's why صبر is different than simple light. It needs a struggle. And then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, والقرآن حجة لك أو عليك. The Quran is an evidence established either for you or against you. In the Day of Judgment, the Qur'an will be for us or against us. وَالْعَيَذُ بِاللَّهِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbid. And that's why one of the early generations of Islam, I think it's Al-Hasan al-Basri, he said, اتَّبِعُوا الْقُرْآنِ follow the Qur'an, وَلَا تَتَّعَلُوا الْقُرْآنَ اتَّبِعُكُمْ أَوْ كَمَا قَالِ if it's him, not someone else. But one of the early generations of Islam, he said this, follow the Qur'an, don't make the Qur'an follow you. You follow the Qur'an, right? Quran is the light in this world that lights the way for us to see what is right and what is wrong and so on. If the Quran is following us, where are we going to get the light? And if the Quran follows someone, he will push him into the hellfire. That means he didn't follow the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the Prophet said, كُلُّ النَّاسْ يَغْدُو all the human being, يَغْدُو الْغُدُو is when you go out in the morning. All people, they go out in the morning. They go out in the morning seeking provisions. You can see how the highways, you might be coming for Fajr, right? And you see all the lights in the dark. When it's winter time, they're all going one direction. Another direction is empty because they're going out for their provisions. There's nothing wrong with going out for provisions, right? And that's what the Prophet ﷺ said, كل الناس, everybody, Muslims, non-Muslims, everybody. Everybody go out. Even if a person stays home and work from home, he's having this setting himself out. He's waking up. He's doing things. Then the people are of two kinds as a result of this. فَبَائِعُ النَّفْسَهُ فَمُعْتِقُ وَأَمُّ بِهُوَ فَبَائِعُ النَّفْسَهُ this word, if we just ponder and reflect over it, it's such an amazing deep meaning to it. فَبَائِعُ النَّفْسَهُ بَائِعُ means selling نَفْسَهُ. Some people, they sell themselves. فَمُعْتِقُهَا and as a result of that, he will free himself from the hellfire forever. Or بَائِعُ النَّفْسَهُ he sold himself. فَمُبِقُهَا that means he ruined himself, he wretched himself, he made himself among the people of the hellfire. That means all people, they sell themselves. When you sell something, it means what? It means you have something You give it to someone in exchange of something else of value to you, money, for example, right? So that's what happens when people go out in the morning. When you go to your work, you're selling yourself. You're selling your knowledge. You're selling your physical effort. It depends what your job is. You're selling your time, because if it's ijara, from 8 to 5, this is your time. This is not your time, this is their time. You sold that time to them. In return, you will get a certain amount of money at the end of the month or so. So you're selling yourself. So everybody sells himself, right? Give himself and his effort and his so on and so forth for something in return. This return either will be Jannah or the Hellfire. And this is how we should see things. So you can imagine someone going and selling himself and making himself tired and studying for years and do all kinds of things, and the return that he waits for at the end of the month is fire. And he keeps on getting fire on himself and so on. Who would work such a job? People would run away from it. Right? But this is the reality of the human being, that most of the human beings are deceived and not knowing this fact. How do we know this? From the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And that's the benefit of an iman. You will get to see things in its real form and shape and so on. So the same thing that makes us so happy that we might think, alhamdulillah, that we're not suffering, but this person is suffering. That thing that we think is a good thing, it can be itself is the hellfire, if it's haram, if it's a sinful life, if it's a sinful act. So it's not according to the comfort and the goodness physically of things that we have in this life. It's according what's the outcome of it. Is it from halal? Is it done for the sake of Allah? Is it without losing the focus in this life? Is it with the iman billah, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, relying on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or something else? So we will see that the point of what we're trying to say here is that al-iman billah, to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is not something that it's in the heart and you lock it in your heart and that's it. It has nothing to do with our speech and actions and reflecting. Of course it's not. It's in everything that we do. And the whole religion of Islam can be explained from that perspective. So before the maqdur, the tawakkul on Allah, to rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or taking the means, take the permissible means only. If it's not permissible, that's not relying on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's relying on other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no way the most high, the most merciful, the most wise, He will forbid us of something that has benefit in it for us. Right? No way. It does not exist. Mr. Sibar, it exists. I make a lot of money from the haram. For example, he says, I make a lot of money from the haram. Right? So he thinks that this is the benefit, that's the means of deception. He's deceived. He's not making anything. He's acquiring hellfire on himself unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives him, or unless he repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Rafi' ibn Khadija radiallahu anhu, he said, Nahana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, an amrin kana lana nafi'a wa ta'atullah Rasulullah anfa'a. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbade us something that was benefiting to us, and the obedience of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is more benefiting to us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the khamr. What about the khamr? That has benefits in it and has harm in it. Right? But the harm is more, that's why it's forbidden. So the same thing can have some benefit in it, but it's haram, that means it has no goodness in it, especially when it comes to matters of the hereafter. So when a person relies on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he knows that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade something, that means it's evil and nothing but evil. There's no goodness in it whatsoever. This reality, if it's present in the heart, then the person will rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he's content, he's not panicking. He's not worried. Like the mother of Musa when she cast her son in the river. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered her. That means the matter is done. It is not her, it's the creator of heavens and earth. So this type of sacrifice of the heart, as we mentioned it before, it's all usually in the heart. Nothing physically will happen. Right? I don't know if anybody knows anyone that starved to death because he's obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or he became homeless because he's obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or disaster happened. This doesn't happen this way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. And we are weak. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows our weakness. It's all within the heart of the human being, and that's why the test. If it's there and the person does and rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. The maqdur happens when he relied on Allah, took the means and everything. Then after that, what comes after that is al-ridha, to be pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. after all of this to be pleased. Why? Because that's from the most wise. Subhanahu wa ta'ala, he knows best and he's more merciful than us to ourselves. So the person is pleased, and the outcome of it, as the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for example, about the man who come in the Day of Judgment, if he was to be dragged on his face for 8 years or for his life during this life, he would see this nothing in the Day of Judgment. Right? The punishment in the grave, nothing compared to the miseries of this life. The delight after this life and in Jannah and in the Day of Judgment, nothing compared to the, all the delight that is present in this life. The mawdi'u sawti ahadikum khayru min ad-dunya wa fiha. The place of the stick of one of you in Jannah is better than this whole world and whatever it contains. Yes, this is unseen, this is what's coming ahead, but that's what an iman is all about. Right? And this is the test that a Muslim has to be sincere in doing. The deen is not about dunya. The deen is not about this life. It's of course to live in this life and to be productive and to do all kinds of good things and so on. But we're not seeking with this with these actions anything in this dunya. We're seeking things in the hereafter. The meaning of which, whoever think that the deen of Islam, that he becomes religious and righteous so that Allah will bless his wealth, so that Allah will bless his family and children, so that they have a goodly life and healthy and so on, then he doesn't understand the deen in the right way. This is not why we hold fast to the deen of Allah. What we seek as a deed done by the heart, we're seeking nothing but the reward in the hereafter. And if a person is sincere like this, then he will get the blessings in his wealth and his family and so on. He will get it. But if his heart is seeking nothing but the hereafter, right? And this is what the prophets, they promised their people. As Nuh alayhi salam, he said to his people, فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا وَيُمْدِدُكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارًا. He said to his people, اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ, seek forgiveness from your Lord. إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا, he is the most forgiving. He will send on you midrara, the sky will rain in abundance and you will have the rizq and the provisions and wealth and offspring. But you will get this if you are sincere in seeking forgiveness from Allah. Seeking forgiveness means do not punish us in the hereafter as a result of our actions. Repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the key to all means of goodness that the heart is seeking the hereafter. And yes, the deen of Islam is not a play. It's a serious work, right? And again, as we said, a person see it from a distance, he would think it's difficult. But for those who are steadfast, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring this weakness of an iman in the heart, but it's a serious matter. And as one of the imaginations of Islam, he said, one of which, when he said, as-salah wa an-nawm ladheel, for example, right? Salah and sleeping is a ladheel, no, laziz. Laziz means what? Tasty. Who said that when a person is being woke up for salah, or whether it's the hajj or salat al-fajr, that he doesn't like to sleep? Everybody likes to sleep. Right? But the salah, this is the order of Allah. You will enjoy waking up for the salah if the iman is present in the heart. Enjoy it what? Physically? Not necessarily what the soul carries, the physical things that brings us down to this earth. So the same thing, sawm, fasting, is not an easy thing. Giving charity is not an easy thing. Like we're greedy by nature. But when a person would work on himself, like winging and so on, winging ourselves, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would make it easy. Seeking the rewards in the hereafter, and this is what the companions of Allah anhu, they never sought anything in this life. So we need to take that away from our heart, that we're not seeking with the religion anything of this world, we're seeking the reward in the hereafter. And if we are sincere in this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us the best of this life and the hereafter. The Prophet was the most happiest individual the humanity knew about. The rest that we not just know about them, but the happiest individual ever. أَلَمْ نَشْرَحْ لَكَ صَدْرَكَ. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. أَلَمْ نَشْرَحْ لَكَ صَدْرَكَ. He's the happiest man ever. عَلَيْهِ صَلَاةُ وَسَلَامُ. You look at his physical life, there's nothing. Right? And the Prophet would sleep on a straw mat that would mark on his side. Right? And if we talk about the subject, there are many things. But he was the happiest person on earth. Because the mercy of Allah, the justice of Allah, he made the place of happiness. It's not on our tongue, or on our skin, or our faces, it's in our hearts. And no one owns this heart except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the owner of the heart. You cannot even control your heart. You cannot switch anything in it. it's owned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the Prophet ﷺ, his most frequent dua, Allahumma muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik, Allah, the changer of the heart, make my heart steadfast on your religion. And also asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify oneself and to purify one's heart and soul. The belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the many aspects of it, but to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, he's the only one worthy of worship. To believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his names and attributes, and to live our life according to this. And more aspects, of course, but we will try to be brief, inshallah ta'ala, to finish the pillars of the iman. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who the hearts are attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to forgive our sins, and to make us in the companionship of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sallallahu sallam wa alayhi wa muhammad wa alayhi wa sallam. Wa subhanaka rabbal wa bihamdik ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. And by the way, since we're